Aarti C Rajarathnam. She is an innovative curriculum and educational design consultant and has been instrumental in designing innovative classrooms and curriculum models in India and abroad. She has set up schools for children in the rural areas of India to cater to the needs of the first generation learners to ensure that their educational and nutritional needs are met. She helped rehabilitate over 7,500 children in the coastal areas of Tamil Nadu after the tsunami in 2004, along with partner NGOs and teachers working in local schools. She nurtured more than 1,000 young students through an innovative and scientifically sound curriculum that integrated the principles of psychology, education, science and spirituality very effectively. She works closely with learning disabilities, developmental disabilities and pervasive developmental disorders like autism. She has a child guidance center and counseling clinic in Salem and in Chennai, where she uses a combination of therapies from West and the East to touch the lives of children with varying degrees of psychological and educational problems. She also counsels adults with problems and mental illness. Miss Aarti C. Rajarathnam.
To be here today. I don't know whether I am really eligible even to introduce her to all of us, but just I want to say, ma'am, that we are blessed today, and maybe our parents who are so interested to know you and listen to you, they are waiting for you for a long time, and it's 2 years down the lane that we could bring you here, and we are really, really happy and grateful to you for coming to Chitrakoota. Welcome, ma'am. Please come.
Good morning. I know Sunday morning and you've given it to your children. I think that's the biggest commitment to parenting. And surprisingly, in a parenting session, the people who don't really need it are the ones who will come. Okay? Just like somebody who always has a six-pack is going to the gym to work out. But the one who needs to be actually working out is not going to the gym. But having said that, parenting is something that we will learn to do all through our life, because it's not a perfect process. It's a process that will develop us as human beings all through. Are you all with me? Right? So 3 hours sitting down is going to be the biggest punishment for anybody. But I promise you that I will not have you sitting down for very long. We will have a lot of interaction, a lot of areas, and I would definitely like to address some of your concerns. And 10 years back, if they told you that you were going to have a parenting session, nobody would have turned up, because it was not such a challenging thing to do. But now, with so much changing around us, we really do need to equip ourselves every day, right? So stay with me through the next couple of hours as we discover what we can do every day. And what I'm going to share with you is not from any American textbook. I promise you that, because very often when you look at parenting information online, it's almost always from one culture, and it does not work for us in many ways. Are you all with me? Right? And why is that very important? Because all Asian cultures value relationships more than achievement. Most Western cultures look at achievement over relationships. And therefore, many of the parenting theories that have been written, that have been put up online, are okay for an achievement-driven culture, not so much for a relationship-driven culture. What happened? Everybody's very silent again. Am I making sense to you? Which is why when they say, give a time out to the child, you're wondering, why will I exclude my child from something? I would rather have my child feeling more connected with me than feeling excluded. Am I making sense to you? Right? When they say, give your child food only when he is hungry, in your culture, your mother-in-law is probably going to kill you for not feeding your child. Okay? So we'll look at it more culture specifically also, and we'll take back a lot today. Can we do that? Yes. So also, many of you, I know you have your notebooks out and you're taking notes and all that, but remember, you don't need to do that, because I'm going to work on 10 areas and I will anchor them onto your fingers so that every time you touch that finger, you will know what to do. So we'll start with the first one. Okay, so can we put our thumb out? Thumb rule, as we say it, starting with the first thing, the most important thing for our children, starting with the thumb, is sleep. And I know it's dangerous on a Sunday morning to start with the word sleep, okay? And though it's dangerous, it's the single most important need for our children, because this generation, including us, we are the most sleep-deprived generation ever to inhabit planet Earth. Are you all with me? And so much of research has gone into how heart disease is linked to sleep, stress is linked to sleep, everything that we are doing is linked to sleep. But where I'm most concerned is that our children not having sufficient sleep is impacting so much, because our lifestyles have changed. I don't know if you remember when we were children, the shops used to close by about 7:38. Most people were home by 8 o'clock. So children always had both their parents at home just before they were going to sleep. Now with our work cultures changing, most children don't get to see their parents till 11 in the night also. And very young children want to wait till the father comes home or the mother comes home to fall off to sleep. Does this make sense to you? I think somewhere, if you can remember that children are young only once, you could see how you can change the time you come back home. What is the first rule? And are there things you can do to change the way your child goes to sleep? Second, more important than the sleep timing, is the sleep ritual. Most children, you will notice when you want to make them sleep, that's when they have a million questions to ask you. Right? And many of you know that they have extremely high energy just before they're going to sleep. Amma, you know what happened? Till then you were asking what happened in school, what happened in school, what happened in school. No answers came. Just when you took them to the bed and said, now close your eyes, you know what happened in school today? And you're like, I asked you the whole evening. Why do you suddenly have so much energy now? Most children are very excited to be with you. For them, you are the most important, not the teenager for young children, okay? For most children, you are the most important person. Am I making sense to you? And therefore, many of them are going to be so excited to just be able to spend that time with you. And so, when they have undivided attention just before they're going to sleep, they're going to want to connect. So it's important for having a nighttime ritual so that they fall asleep without this excitement. Number one, please ensure it's the same time. Because you know, if the biological clock knows this is the time to fall asleep, it's going to naturally make them sleepy at that time. But second, more important, make sure that before they go to sleep, so they're going to sleep at 9, at 7:30, you will stop any kind of white light related screen time. If you don't have screen time, even better, but at least 1.5 hours before, there shouldn't be white light going into the retina. Most children are watching a mobile just as they're dozing off. It works very negatively for the brain. We'll talk about gadgets a little later, but I'd like you to understand this. But the most important aspect of the ritual is what I call the bedtime debriefing. Last few minutes that the child is going off to sleep, have calm conversations. Don't have exciting things like, you know what happened today. Don't have a lot of laughter, etc. Because then anything is going to trigger off, let me stay awake. Are you all with me? Now when you go out with friends and you have a lot of laughter, do you say, okay, now it's my sleep time? No, you say, okay, let's laugh a little more. And then you find every trivial thing to laugh about. So please make that a very calm time. If you really want to laugh with your child, laugh in the morning before they come to school. Because laughter is very good in the morning, okay, because it gears you up for the whole day. But having said that, the debrief is very simple. Please ask the child what they really, one thing that they really enjoyed about their day. Let the child connect back to the whole day and become grateful for that one thing that they enjoyed very much. Most children will have more than one, and let them be grateful for it. Two, what was the one thing that they really enjoyed learning during the day? So they could have learned something new in mathematics. They could have learned to be kinder. Can be anything. What was the one thing that you learned today? And the third most important question, what would you like to do differently tomorrow? Everybody is very silent again. It's three questions we can ask ourselves as well, but we also ask our children these three questions, because when they ask this, it helps them have a healthier mind to be able to deal with every day. And they also understand, when I ask these three questions and when I answer these three questions, my bonding with my parent becomes more deep. And as the child is sleeping, please give them a lot of positive messages, starting with, I love you. You're an extremely talented, intelligent person. And if you have anything specific to give the child, keep giving them positive messages as they're going to sleep. Subconscious mind holds on to it. The whole night, it works on it. And when the child wakes up in the morning, they feel much more confident. Are you all with me? Very often, the last minute is when we are shouting, why didn't you remember to do that homework? Tomorrow I'll wake you at 5 o'clock, you have to finish it. And the child is saying, oh God, I can't sleep today. All the stress hormones have kicked in. All of you are laughing, but very honestly, if they go to bed feeling these three positive statements, your relationship becomes much, much more meaningful. Everybody's clear with the first rule? What we can do about it? Do the second rule now. Can everybody put your hand out like this? Okay, this is the size of your stomach. Heart also. I know we've been told heart and we just said heart. But I have to use stomach because today's parent somehow feels children can eat so much. Right? In the Indian culture, food is such an important thing. Somebody comes home, first question, what do you want to eat? Okay? And somehow if you don't serve them food, you're a bad person. Culturally, you know, we are considered bad if we have not served food. First, you have to give water, of course. Before food, one glass of water. They should have had water and then you're like, what will you eat? You're like, no, I've eaten fully. No, you must eat. Okay? You know, I'm having a heart attack. You have food and then have the heart attack. Because we really don't really want to stop them from eating. And then, if possible, we give them the whole meal as well. And the person is saying, no, I've just had lunch, but we don't respect it. Because the culture does revolve around food. Okay? In most emotionally charged cultures, food is a very important aspect. Are you all with me? And it's not wrong, but please don't feed the child based on your needs for hunger. Okay? And let me tell you, one of the most dangerous things that's happening now. So recently in Chennai, I had the advantage of visiting a school because it opened my mind in a way that I was shocked. So this school was what I typically call the opportunists' school, because the management was looking at every opportunity to earn money. Okay? So in the afternoon, I was sitting down and there was a smart board in the class. And the teacher told me, by the way, ma'am, would you also like to watch our lunchtime videos? I said, what do you mean by lunchtime videos? So she said, in the first parent-teacher interface that we had with the parents, most parents told me, my child does not eat if they don't watch Chota Bheem. Okay? So what we have done, in our fee structure, we have increased 5,000 rupees for lunchtime videos. Am I making sense to you? Now, when we were growing up, grandmother or aunt or mother, whoever was raising us, would be carrying us, showing us a lot of things, and they would feed us. We had like a lot of conversation around the food. And that was a very different aspect of learning, because there was reciprocity. The child had a bonding that was happening with a human being, which is why it was beneficial. Today's child is not bonding, it's getting addicted. There's a difference between bonding with someone and getting addicted to something. The group is very silent. I know, but these are very deep, introspective silences, right? Please remember, one of the reasons for obesity is when people don't focus on what they're eating. Another reason for bad health is when I don't know what I'm eating. So many years back, you've heard of Benjamin Spock. Some of you may be familiar that his parenting book at one point was considered the Bible for parenting, the pediatrician. So I know many years back a friend of mine had a baby, and since they were staying in the US, they didn't know how to raise the baby on their own. So there was no wisdom from a grandparent to come in. So she read Benjamin Spock. It said so many milliliters of calcium, so many mg of this one, so many mg of this one. There was a list of what nutrients should go into the child's body for every meal. And then it also told them what were the sources of that. So every day she would take the blender, add some chicken, add some papaya, add some yucky green thing, this one. Whatever Benjamin Spock had mentioned as sources would be put inside the blender, beaten up, and it would look like dog vomit. Okay, and I'm not even going to exaggerate this. It looked really gross and it smelled even worse than that. Okay, and then she would have husband doing one important duty, holding the child back. Because obviously you serve something so bad, no child is going to say, ah, yummy, I'm going to eat. Okay, and he would, poor thing, hold the child down and the mother would be feeding the baby. And at one point, imagine the whole blender. Child would feel so sick, but she'll say, no, but Spock says you have to have 19 milligrams of calcium. And he was going in, and the last spoonful, child would throw up everything. And then she would take the next blender and start making this concoction again. I'm not exaggerating. I've met every kind of parent there is, and I've realized that around food, we are very anxious. When I was running the school in Salem, one parent came and told me, madam, child is born after 15 years of marriage, so if she doesn't study, it's okay. Please ensure that she's eating. Okay, so this child would come with a small school bag and one strolly bag for lunch. Okay? Okay, I'm not even kidding. And anytime you see the child and you ask her, Soundarya, ipa enna ma panna? She's like, ma'am, snacks after ma'am. Okay, she would have just eaten snacks. After 20 minutes, you ask her, Soundarya, ipa enna ma panna? Ma'am, lunch after ma'am. Okay, every time she's eaten something. Okay, and though I'm not exaggerating, what I'm trying to say is this child's entire world revolved around food. So when you ask children, close your eyes and think about what you really like, there would be children talking about, you know, I like an aeroplane or I like my mother. They would have diverse interests. And Soundarya's answer, I like jalebi. So her entire world was around food. And what I'm trying to tell you is, not that it's necessarily bad or good, but when we start obsessing about something, there's a difference between enjoying something and obsessing about something. When we are obsessing about something, it becomes more difficult for the child. What is a simple rule for food then? Let your child eat when they're hungry. Because I must be aware what is thirst, what is hunger. If we do not create needs for these two, children have difficulties with reading and writing later. Why? Because my awareness of my body is very important for my awareness of learning. Are you all with me? Right? And children, very young children, in the brain do not differentiate hunger from thirst. They just get cranky. So we assume that every time they're crying, they need to be fed. Traditionally, we allow them to feel hungry for at least three and a half hours. Whatever the size of your plate, that's fine. I can take it later, thank you. So whatever the size of the plate, divide it into three equal portions. One portion has to be a carbohydrate. Your carbohydrate sources, rice. Rice can be any of the cereals, right? It can be, minor millets, all of those. But you take only one. Don't take all of them. Since she said all minor millets, let's give a little bit of this, a little bit of that. Take one. Whatever quantity of the carbohydrate you have, same quantity of protein physically, and same quantity of vitamin. If you have all three equally done, the child will definitely feel hungry in 3 hours. Where we make a mistake is one rich protein diet, just one omelette in the morning, because it's easy to feed the child. Or just a little bit of rice, just a little bit of this. When you do only one, nutritionally the child is not balanced. Second, they're going to feel more sleepy. They're going to feel more distracted. And a lot of fidgetiness in the classroom comes when the child has not eaten balanced diet. Are you all with me? And the rule, you don't have to, we learnt mineral salts, all these things. No, you don't need to bring in all of these things. You just make sure three parts of your plate and all three parts are the same quantity. Plus, protein is difficult to chew. So it develops aspects of the oromotor muscles, develops the language centers as well. Carbohydrate is very gentle, soft, easy to digest. Vitamins, fastest to digest, but they all have complementary enzymes which help each other. Am I making sense to all of you? Can we all stand up for a minute? Because you know, the position that you are sitting in, technically, the position that you are sitting in, no learning happens. Okay, which is why I still believe children should sit cross-legged on the floor, because it gives them a lot more focus. It works on a lot of, the muscle development which is required for learning. And you know, if you're sitting in this level, and if I was standing in one corner and speaking, today I would have lost all of you, right? I kept moving, so at least your eyes were tracking, right? Which is very, very difficult when you have a group of 400 people. I need to keep you completely engaged. So do we have the first rule of sleep? The second rule of food? And more than anything else, these two rules apply to us first, then to the child. Because if we don't follow it, it's not going to ever be followed by the child. So shall we do some activity now? Because we've all been sitting for a long time. So I'm going to give you the third area. So you'll need to move around a little bit. Okay? So please don't stay inside your comfort zone. Okay, I already know this person, I'm going to speak to this person kind of thing. I need you to meet somebody you've not met. I'd like you to come out of your comfort zone. Are you all with me? So before I go into comfort zone, can I tell you a story as you're standing? So the king of Persia was gifted two falcons. And you know, in Persia, falcon, if you actually visit even parts of Qatar and all, even now they have the falcon market, if you've seen it. So the falcon used to be sent to send messages across the desert because it was a very resilient bird. So the king of Persia was given two beautiful falcons, and he called the falconer and he said, please train the falcons to fly. One falcon got trained within 3 days. It was already carrying messages, and then the other falcon, fat slob, was just sitting on the branch and eating every day. And the king tried to keep getting different trainers to get the falcon to fly. It didn't. So then he announced, if anybody can make this falcon fly, I will give you 1,000 gold coins. So a farmer came, and in 10 minutes the falcon was flying. The king was very amazed. He said, please tell me, what is the secret of making the falcon fly? He said, sir, I just cut off the branch on which it was sitting. Okay, so very often all of us like to sit on a comfort zone, right? Especially when we come to school, we are not very sure, can I speak to this person? Please step out of your comfort zone, because this is one of the important modeling that we can give our children. Because what happens, we are very comfortable within our circles and we also expose our children only to that. But today, if we can do anything in our parenting session, it would be stepping out of the comfort zone, because that's where growth is. And if we can model that for our children, it'll be great. Yes? So my first task for you, we have about 6 or 7 tasks and we'll do all of them. Okay? So the first task, and please find somebody new for each of these tasks. Okay? So first question, find, please listen and you will move. You can move anywhere. Find people who are scared of cockroaches and note their names. And you need to find 5 people. Go. Move, move. Find people who are scared of cockroaches. Note down 5 names. Please move. Is there anybody here addicted to tender coconut? But you will have people addicted to Coca-Cola. What happened? Everybody's silent again. Is there anybody here addicted to curd rice? No. We all eat curd rice, that is normal. But addicted means I cannot live without it. That's different. We don't get addicted to natural things, we get addicted to anything that is artificial. The very fact that children are getting addicted to gadgets, it's telling us that it's
artificial. No child gets addicted to playing. They will enjoy playing. They will lose time. They will explore. But they don't get addicted to play. They will keep adding more skills to play. They will not get addicted to play. Am I making sense? Please allow the child to play, because every aspect of it develops an aspect of the brain. One of my videos went viral, but I'll just do it. Can I have the chair again? It was in Tamil, so I'll do it in English. That way it will help a lot more people understand. So now when you have a young child, you give them a chair, they will never sit on the chair. Almost always when you give the chair, and you will say, I spent so much for that chair, don't do that. And the child is saying, oh really? I have to use it. And then what will happen? From here, they have to look at you. What is the child doing? They're developing a new perspective. This is the first level of problem solving. Child learns, when I look at the world like this, there are problems. When I look at it like this, I have another perspective. Am I making sense to you? Yes? Then, next step will come. The one that you dislike the most. Now, don't make noise, don't do anything. But when you see this, what is a child doing? Using an object to explore space. If you stop this play, pencil box will come out. You stop that, hand will come out. What is the child doing? The child is learning pre-writing. When I create shapes using large objects, I learn how to use a pencil or a pen for writing. Am I making sense to you? Then next step. You seen all this? That is how they learn spelling. I add sound to a shape that I have created. That's how they learn spelling. All of this is missing in gadget play. Total silence in the group. At different ages, they will do different things. Adolescents, for example, they will play with friends. They will test relationships. They will fight with friends and they'll come and cry at home. But that's their experimentation. Don't go there and say, don't worry and all that. They have to experiment with relationships at that time. Nature creates it like that. At 8-9 years, they need games with rules. They need to learn winning and losing. At less than that, less than 7, they need games with fantasy. Doctor, doctor, teacher, teacher. Each age, the nervous system has a specific play to develop the nervous system, to develop personality, to develop experiences. If they miss all this and they're playing only on a gadget, personality is stunted first, skills are stunted second, and third, most important, social skills are destroyed. Am I making sense to you? When I say gadget addiction, technology, I won't say that we can do without technology. It has its benefits, but in optimal levels. When a child is given a screen, first, the chemicals in the brain change. Now, we have many different chemicals. Endorphins, when you exercise, when you're happy, when you laugh, endorphins come in. That is a happiness chemical. And it teaches you that happiness is an inside job. It can happen only inside you. You don't develop endorphins when you interact with other people. It comes with your interaction with yourself. Are you all with me? Oxytocin, love hormone. It comes in your interaction with other people. Are you with me? These are two positive chemicals. Then you have serotonin and you have dopamine. Dopamine is the pleasure chemical. When children get a like on Instagram, when they shoot somebody and they fall and they die and they get 13,000 points, dopamine. It's a pleasure seeker. It's very addictive, but it's very short. So the moment that pleasure goes away, they want more dopamine. Which is why when you've got your children addicted to a gadget, it's difficult to take it away. Because they want dopamine. Endorphin you don't get addicted. You know limits, you know balance. Are you all with me? That's the first danger. Second, and more dangerous, when you give children a gadget, the eyes fix in one place. We call it the ocular lock. When the eyes fix in one place, the auditory channel is cut. When your children are watching TV, try calling them. Call them 50 times, they don't respond. Not because they are engrossed in the TV, it's because neurologically, the auditory part is cut off. More and more children with gadget addiction have language delays, are not able to write longer questions. They are not able to maintain conversation. Are you all with me? If you can do one good thing after today's workshop, please remove the screens. Because they will have more and more technology. They'll have fewer you. Already their relationships have reduced. Please let it not also destroy the communication they can have with you. What happened? Everybody's silent. How do you remove it? Number one, who gave it first? I didn't. If you gave it, you gave it. I gave it. Take responsibility. Then who can remove it? Because don't go taking them to a counselor and say, ma'am, he's not listening to me. You know, in the PTA meeting, I have parents coming and saying, ma'am, he doesn't listen to me if I tell him to give away the mobile. Please tell him. And then the teacher, you know, she has no choice, but she has to tell them, Kanna, don't use the gadget, not good for you, not good for you and all that. Next time the child will warn the parent up before the PTA, amma, don't come and tell my teacher anything. Okay, so the teacher out of her own concern will ask, how is he now? Ma'am, now he's okay because now we were scared of the child. Are you all with me? And I'm sure you're facing this. So when parents used to come to my school and tell me, tell my child not to use the TV, I would jokingly say, yes, I know, your remote control is in my hands. When you are a parent, you will say no many times. Children will dislike you for it. But you would have done a good job. By giving them everything, you actually prevent them an opportunity to create new ideas and new interests. Are you all with me? You've heard this analogy where the roots of a tree remain at the surface because the water was easily available. It never searched for its own water. The roots didn't grow deeper. Similar, technology meets their needs very fast. Surface level needs very fast, which is why they're not able to nurture deeper relationships with anyone. Am I making sense to all of you? Can you all stand up? Quickly turn and face a partner. Can you take this away? Turn and face a partner. Everybody has a partner? Yes? No? Yes. Okay. Just ensure that you and your partner didn't grow up in the same place. You should not, like, you could have grown up Bangalore, but you can't have grown up, say, Fraser Town. Okay? Everybody grew up in different places? Yes. Now, please teach your partner, think very carefully, teach your partner five games that you played with your hands and fingers as a child.
Seriously?
kept remembering more, and then you kept saying, people who could not remember, you just so suppressed your playfulness, you become very serious as adults, and you're like, what game did I play? But the aspect that we used here is what we call muscle memory. Okay, what we learn using the body, we never forget all through our life. And my request to you, when you allow children to play, the single most important thing that you're allowing is to allow them to store information for life. So whatever you've taught in studies will be generalized in their play. We'll go through the last few rules. We've done 4 rules so far. 5th more important rule, model, don't manipulate. If you want a behavior in your child, it must already be there in you. So a father came to me and he said, ma'am, I've paid 5,000 rupees, sent him for yoga class. Every day morning he's supposed to practice yoga. He gets up but he doesn't practice. What are you doing at 5 o'clock? I'm sleeping. If you're sleeping, child will also be sleeping, because what we model is what the children will pick up. And this is where adolescence is a very important area that I want to bring in. Many of you have pre-teen, teen years. And I was working right from the younger ages because I want you to understand the gaps that are set there need to be addressed by the time they come to grade 6 and 7. First is, of course, the hormonal changes. Boys have testosterone, girls have more of progesterone, sometimes a little bit of estrogen. What are the symptoms? First, your child is always restless. You know, with boys you'll find that they're drumming the table, you know, restlessly moving from here to there, eating one drum full of biryani and then asking you, do you have any more food to eat? And you're saying, you've eaten so much. But then they're going through the growth spurt, they will eat a lot more than most people, and not your rasam rice and one vegetable. It has to be oily, fried and spicy. For girls, progesterone will make them want to eat only sweets. Are you all with me? Mothers will see their boy with testosterone shouts at you without any reason, and then after 5 minutes comes and hugs you. Sorry, mommy, I won't do this again. It's a testosterone rich experience. For girls, without a reason, they will be crying. And this crying will go this. There will be no tears sometimes. And then you ask them, why are you crying? And then they'll just give you some story of fought with a friend and all that. Nothing would have happened. And you keep on asking, why are you crying? Why are you crying? So they'll say, okay, let me just cook up some story, because otherwise she's not going to leave me. When children cry, just let them finish crying. If they want to tell you, they will tell you. They don't want to tell you, just be supportive. Are you all with me? By knowing what happened, are you going to stop the crying? No, so don't. Am I making sense to you? Right. Then after you know this friend troubled her, then you'll call that mother. Please tell your daughter not to fight with my daughter. And then that mother will ask her daughter and she'll say, we never had a fight. And then this becomes a problem for everybody. Please remember, hormonal changes are not in the child's control. So if you keep asking for reason, they will not be able to give it to you. For the teenager, this part of the skin will become oily, this part will become dry. Don't keep using face washes to remove this oil. This oil is required for the child, baby face, to become an adult face. It's a natural oil. What happened? Everybody's silent again. You've been putting face wash and removing it, and the body is secreting more and more, and the child is getting acne and pimples and all these things. Don't work against nature. Am I making sense to you? Yes. More important are the emotional changes. When I asked you how many of you have stage fear, quite a number of you raised your hand. Every day you speak to people, how is it different from speaking on stage? How is it different? You believe you're the center of attraction. What will happen if you're the center of attraction? You'll be very happy. I know you were very happy. I'm asking. Yes. You may fear. I may commit a mistake and they will ridicule me. Right? And we call it technically the audience effect. Every teenager, and when we say teenager, right from the age of 10, they believe that between 50 and 500 people are always watching them. Which is why teenage suicides are so high. Somebody would have called them separately and yelled at them, and the child would come and say, in front of everyone she insulted me. Who is the everyone? The audience in their head. That's why you'll see all these stupid articles, no? He stood in front of one train and took a selfie. Because he believes everybody is watching them. I'll give you another example. As a parent, you will definitely know this. Try and take your teenager for a wedding or a housewarming ceremony. First, I'm not coming. Okay? Then you'll say, no, they came home and invited us, you must come and all that. And the teenager will say, no, I'm not coming, that grandmother will do this. They'll ask me which class you're studying in, what are you doing, all these things. Because they're scared, the whole audience is watching them. Then the big problem will come. Open the cupboard, I have nothing to wear. Okay, why don't you wear this one, why don't you wear this one, why don't you wear this one? They'll have excuse for each dress. Even if water is stagnant, they will be combing their hair. You'll see your teenager in front of the mirror 15 minutes just combing their hair. It's not because they're obsessed with the body, it's because they have the imaginary audience. That's why it's important not to insult your teenager in front of anybody. Are you all with me? Next, more important, personal fable. Every teenager believes he or she is the hero or the heroine of their own story. So if some incident happens and you ask your child and you ask another child, two different stories will come to you. They are not lying, they are saying it from their narrative perspective. Respect it. Third, they will search identity, so you are no longer ideal. Till 9 years, 10 years, mother knows everything, father is the most intelligent, teacher is very, very, very good. Then suddenly at 11 years, that old man is my father. Okay? Amma, tell your husband to speak to me properly. Okay? That man, she has many degrees and all, but I don't think she knows anything. Okay? They are not disrespecting you, they are growing up to be normal. At this age, if they are not rebelling against you, they are abnormal. Are you all with me? Because it is a search for identity. Do not choose this time to go and show your Hitler powers. You know, we were all respectful of our parents. In our days, we were not like this. We were not like this because there was not so much violence, there was not so much of a challenge. We had a huge support group and we had brothers, sisters, cousins to guide us through adolescence. Are you all with me? Please do not compare your childhood with theirs. They do not have role models. What happened? The only role models they have are cricketers who are earning a lot of money. Yes, heroes who used to be originally the good heroes, now the porkies and the pokeries are the heroes. They do not have any normal role model. They live in very unusual times. Please understand, it's never easy. Are you all with me? Next, more important, they will move towards friends. Family is no longer important. Same thing you would have told them and a friend will tell them, whom will they follow? Friends. And it's normal, respect it. And to be excluded by the friends group is equivalent to murder. Children cannot expect or accept that the friends do not like them. Are you all with me? And when they come and say, Amma, I don't have any friends, I'm feeling very sad, don't say, I will be your friend. They don't want you. Remember that. Don't step in to be your child's friend. Be the parent. They can make friends of their own age, but they have only two parents. So when a parent says, I'm like a friend, you've failed in your duty as a parent. Are you all with me? I know many of you dislike that. But let's remember, we shouldn't be our child's friend. We can have two-way communication, yes. We can be supportive, yes. We can guide them, yes. But we can't be friends. Friends are always peer group. Are you with me? I'll tell you an example. So the child, 13-year-old, 14-year-old, suddenly has infatuation, comes and says, I really like this boy in my class. You can't go there and say, oh yeah, go enjoy it. No. We were also like this. Then as a parent, when you say that, you're giving them license. Within friends, when they discuss it, they discuss it within their own maturity level, they figure out how to deal with that relationship. Am I making sense to you, all of you? Yes? Please remember that they need to have friendship experiences to make sense of the reality that they live in. Next, more important, they will have infatuation. When estrogen is high, testosterone is high, the girl and the boy will definitely get attracted. When something like this happens, wait for 24 hours before you do anything. In 24 hours, estrogen goes away. The girl will usually be very clear at the end of 24 hours that she does not like the boy. In between that, you go there and say, this boy is not good for you. See how he looks, see how are you, our family and their family. Till then, the child was not looking at anything long term. Am I making sense to you? The moment you gave all these ideas, the child's brain says, oh, there are new ideas now. Are you all with me? Just let it be. They will learn how to friend zone the people. They call it friend zoning. I hope you know that it's from their generation. When they can't deal with somebody, they friend zone them. Just like in our generation, we used to go and tie this Rakhi thing, no? Like that. Are you all with me? Now one of you have some experience, some reference. Now they have friend zoning. They're like, no, you're not. They don't say brother and all. You're like, friend, but I don't like you in any other way. You have to allow them to friend zone people. You will not decide that for them. And the last aspect of teenagers, the emotional part is larger, the thinking part is smaller. They cannot solve their problems easily. The emotions will come up. Don't start using your emotions against them. Don't model anger. When they lose marks, don't become angry because they're already not able to deal with failure. When children fail, give them feedback how they can improve their performance. Because their thinking part is smaller, they need guidance on how to improve, not on how to be punished. Okay, I'm going to stop with this and I'm going to leave it open to questions, because as we answer the questions, the other five rules will be completed. If there are no questions, it usually means you understood everything or you didn't understand anything. Okay.